So welcome to Digimento. So I'll be dealing with paper 1 for national eligibility test, that is NET ka paper 1. So before that, this is Digimento. So we are the best platform for preparing for GATE, NTA, also for the NET exams, PGT. So you can subscribe to our channel, and also please press the bell icon for getting the notifications. Be the first one to be notified about our upcoming videos. So please subscribe to our channel and also press the bell icon. And you can also visit our website www.digimento.com, or you can also make a call to any of these numbers for getting more information about the courses that we provide. So I'll be dealing with paper 1, a few topics from paper 1. So basically, this is unit 9 of paper 1. So here in unit 9, you will see that it deals with people, development and environment. So these are the topics that comes under unit 9, people, development and environment. So we will quickly go through the topics. Then I'll come to an introduction. I'll give you an introduction about the NET examination. So NTA NET examination, I'll give you an introduction about the examination. But before that, we will quickly go through unit 9. So unit 9, as I said, it deals with people, development and environment. So we will see what are the subtopics that comes under this particular unit. So first one is development and environment. So here we will be discussing about Millennium Development Goals and Sustainable Development Goals. Also, we will discuss about human and environment interaction. That is, what is the relationship between human beings and environment. So here we will be discussing about anthropogenic activities and their impacts on the environment. So anthropogenic is nothing but human activities. So what are various human activities that has an impact on environment? Then we will discuss about environmental issues, local issues, regional issues and global issues, which includes various types of pollution, climate change, socio-economic and political dimensions of these issues. Then we will come to impact of pollutants and pollutants on human health. Next is natural and energy resources, which includes solar energy, wind energy, soil, hydro, geothermal, biomass, nuclear and forest. Then we will see natural hazards and disasters and what are the mitigation strategies. So next is Environmental Protection Act of 1986. Then National Action Plan on Climate Change. International agreements like the Montreal Protocol, Rio Summit, Convention on Biodiversity, Kyoto Protocol, Paris Agreement, International Solar Alliance, etc. So here you will see that this entire thing, this is taken from your syllabus. So all these topics, it is taken from your syllabus. Nothing more has been added. So my purpose will be to teach you this unit 9. We will complete comprehensively this unit 9, which will help you to crack all the questions that comes from this particular unit. But before we move on, two things that I want to tell you. First thing is, what will we be doing today? So in this lecture, first thing that we will do is, I'll give you an introduction regarding the NET, that is the National Eligibility Test Examination. So it is conducted by NTA, National Testing Agency. So we will have an introductory talk regarding this examination. Then we will look into this unit 9, the syllabus, unit 9 of the syllabus in detail. So we will see the syllabus in detail. And then we will also try to complete some of the terms and terminologies related to this unit if time permits. So let's quickly see what is this exam about. Let me give you an introduction about this examination, the UGC or the NTA NET. So now it's conducted by NTA, National Testing Agency. So NTA. So let's quickly see what is this exam all about. Many of you, or almost all of you, might have heard about this examination, NET examination. So what is this NET examination? The NET examination, NET, it stands for National Eligibility Test. So what kind of eligibility is being tested here? So here the question is, what eligibility? So the examination, it checks the eligibility of Indian nationals for eligibility to become assistant professors in various colleges and universities. So if you want to become an assistant professor in any university or in any college in India, then you have to give this examination. Also the JRF, Junior research fellowship examination. The same, it's combined with the NET examination, but the cutoff marks will be different. So if you want to do your PhD or if you want to pursue the junior research fellowship, then also you can apply for this examination, which is conducted by NTA. So this is the very purpose, to check the eligibility of Indian nationals to become assistant professors or to get into the junior research fellowship. So this is the very purpose of this test, and since 2018 December, this test is being conducted by the NTA. NTA is National Testing Agency. So National Testing Agency is conducting the examination since 2018 December, and the NTA National Testing Agency, it is established by MHRD. MHRD is Ministry of Human Resource Development, and the NTA, it's a national testing agency. It's an independent and self-reliant premier testing organization to conduct various tests. So that is the purpose of NTA. And the examination, the NET examination, there are two papers, paper 1 and paper 2. So basically two papers are there, paper 1 and paper 2. And it's basically an online examination of 180 minutes. Which means 3 hours. So 180 minutes, 3 hour examination, two papers, paper 1 and paper 2. Now this is conducted online. The examination is conducted online. And coming to both the papers, let's first see paper 1. So paper 1. Paper 1, it consists of 50 questions. So 50 questions, and they are two markers. So 50 into 2, total of 100 marks. So 50 questions of 2 marks each. And paper 2, it comprises of like 100 questions, so double the number compared to paper 1. So 100 questions into 2 marks, so it makes a total of 200. So altogether 300 marks, 100 marks in paper 1 and 200 marks in paper 2. So together it is 300 marks. Now, this paper 1 and paper 2, these two papers, they are held consecutively. That means there is no break between these two papers. So a total of 180 minutes will be given to the candidate to solve both these papers. And now paper 1. So paper 1 is common for every NET candidate. So every candidate who is appearing for this examination, the paper 1 is the same. It will test your general awareness, your teaching ability, your reasoning ability, logical ability, etc. So these are the things that is covered in paper 1, and paper 1 will be same for each candidate. For every candidate, it is the same. Now paper 2. Paper 2 is related to your subject, which means whichever subject you are specialized in. So the paper 2 is basically based on the subject that is chosen by the candidate, whereas paper 1 is common for everyone. Now paper 1 and 2 both are compulsory. Now so these are the two papers, and as I said, I'll be dealing with few of the topics from paper 1. So my area will be, or my part here will be, to cover few areas or few topics from paper 1. So that will be my purpose. And today, as I said, we will be starting with this 9th unit, that is People, Development and Environment. We have already seen the syllabus in some brief. Now what we'll be doing, we'll be going into the detail of the syllabus. Now why it's important to go into the detail of the syllabus? The reason is that competitive examinations like the NET or any other competitive examination, especially national level examination, the examiner will stick on to the syllabus. First thing a candidate has to do is to familiarize with the syllabus. Once the candidate knows the syllabus very well, it's very easy for the candidate. So that is why first we will be looking into the syllabus of this examination in very detail. Then we will cover each and every topic of the syllabus to make sure that you will definitely answer all the questions from this particular area. So we will first get familiarized with the syllabus. So as I said, the name of the unit 9, the unit 9 name is Development and Environment. So from the name itself, you will get some clue regarding what is this topic all about. So how is development connected to environment, or how we can interrelate environment and development? So here we will see what are the subtopics. The first subtopic, as we already saw briefly, is about Millennium Development Goals. Millennium Development Goals, which expired in 2015, and now we have the Sustainable Development Goals going on. We will come to that also. So Millennium Development Goals, there are basically 8 Millennium Development Goals. We will discuss that in detail in a separate lecture. So this will be a series of lectures which will help you cover the Unit 9 completely. Any question asked from Unit 9, you will be able to answer. So Millennium Development Goals, they are 8 in number. The first one is to eradicate extreme poverty and hunger. So first goal is related to poverty and hunger, and from the Indian context, again, this is very important. Why? Because in India, one of the major social development problems that we face is poverty. Since independence, or even before independence, and especially after independence, when the policy making, the agenda of policy making came into being, one of the biggest problems the policy makers, the government, the legislature, even the bureaucracy faces it very difficult to manage or tackle is to eradicate poverty. There are various government initiatives, various government schemes. We will briefly cover all that when we come to this topic specifically. So first goal is to eradicate extreme poverty and hunger. Second one is to achieve universal primary education. Now, how is this related to India? Now, as we said, the Millennium Development Goals, they expired in 2015. But can you remember anything that happened in India? Any major legislation that happened in India called the RTE? That is Right to Education. So, Right to Education was formulated in India, keeping in mind this second Millennium Development Goal, that is achievement of universal primary education, that is providing the primary education to everyone in the country. Now, third Millennium Development Goal is to promote gender equality and empowerment of women. So it deals with women empowerment and promoting gender equality. Again, we will see what are the schemes like reservation of seats in panchayats. Then again, many other schemes for the empowerment of women. You can even think about the maternity benefits given by the government for women. So all these things are included here. Fourth is to reduce the child mortality. Child mortality refers to the death of children below the age of 1 year. This is called infant mortality. Then we also have below 5. Then child basically refers to below 18. But within child mortality, what is most important is infant mortality. Why? Because the infant mortality rates in India is very high. Now we are reducing it, but it was very high. Now it's been reduced. So for that also, government has come up with various schemes. We will discuss briefly about them also. So this is the fourth goal. Fifth is improve maternal health. So this includes reducing the maternal mortality rate, or which is called MMR. For that, government has provided various benefits, maternal benefits to pregnant mothers and lactating mothers, like maternal leave, then many government initiatives, free medical checkup. So all these we will see, free vaccination, all that includes. Now sixth one is combating HIV, AIDS, malaria and other diseases. So reducing the disease burden, especially of malaria, HIV, AIDS, etc. Seventh is environmental sustainability. So this is very important. Why? Because we are anyways dealing with this ninth unit, which talks about development and environment. So here the seventh goal under the Millennium Development Goal is to ensure sustainability. What is meant by sustainability? Sustainability means judicious use of resources so that the future generation will also be able to pursue or to get the benefits of the environmental resources. So this is the seventh goal, and the eighth one is Global Partnership for Development. So global partnership means international organizations, the role of international organizations, also the partnership of various countries, that is international level steps or measures to be taken. So these are the Millennium Development Goals. We are not going into every detail of it, because as I said, this lecture is basically meant to introduce you with the syllabus, and then with the upcoming lectures we will get into all these topics in much detail. Now second subtopic that is covered in your syllabus in Unit 9 is Sustainable Development Goals, or what we call SDGs. And I would say that this is even more important than Millennium Development Goals, MDGs. Millennium Development Goals were MDGs, whereas these are SDGs or Sustainable Development Goals. So SDGs are even more important. Why? Because this is ongoing. It started in 2015. And it will end in 2030, which means these goals has to be achieved by 2030. So this is Sustainable Development Goals, and there are a total of 17. I am not going into the details of all now, because we will discuss each one of them in much detail from your examination perspective. So I am not going into the detail of all these. Yeah, first one, we will just briefly, quickly glance through each goal. First one is again, eliminating poverty. Now, if you compare it with Millennium Development Goal, we will see eradicate extreme poverty and hunger. But here, no poverty. No poverty means eradication, complete eradication of poverty. This is the first Sustainable Development Goal. Second one is zero hunger. So again, eradication, complete eradication. Third is good health and well-being. So this is related to health of individuals, health, not only health, but also well-being. Fourth is quality education. Why quality education? Because quality of education matters a lot. Now, if we take the case of India, now Sustainable Development Goals are global goals. Don't forget that this is not just for India. These are global goals. We will discuss all that. But if we take the case of India, we know that we have RTE, right to education, and under right to education, primary education is given to every child free of cost. But various reports, for example, the ACER report, many other reports which checks the quality of education in India, even the Niti Aayog report, which has checked about the quality of education in India, it said that even though India is able to provide free and compulsory education under the RTE, the quality of education is very less. Now, how is this quality of education calculated? It is calculated, or it's observed in terms of the outcomes like the reading ability, reading capacity, or solving some mathematical problems. So all these parameters are used to check the quality of education. And various reports have found out that not just in case of India, in many developing countries and least developed countries, the quality of education remains very low. And therefore, the Sustainable Development Goals have adopted quality education. Not only the provision of education, but also the provision of quality education as one goal. Fifth one is gender equality. Again, it deals with women empowerment and provision of equal opportunities for all genders. Now, sixth is clean water and sanitation, the basic necessities of life like cleaning, clean water and sanitation. Clean water here refers to clean drinking water. And we can also here connect many schemes that are ongoing in India to provide piped water connection or clean water in urban and rural areas. We'll come to that when we discuss about SDGs in detail. The seventh SDG is affordable and clean energy. So energy, both renewable and non-renewable. We also have many schemes going on in the country. Ujjwala Yojana, many other schemes which provides free or low cost energy. Then eighth one is decent work and economic growth, that is employment facilities, availability of employment opportunities, and provision of employment facilities and economic growth. Economic growth is measured in terms of GDP. We will come to economic growth and economic development, and we will also see what are the differences between economic growth and development. So decent work, that is provision of employment opportunities and economic growth. Ninth one is industry, innovation and infrastructure. So industry, innovation, infrastructure. And tenth is reduced inequalities. Inequalities can be of different types. It can be income inequality, gender inequality, or social inequality. So inequality in all forms should be reduced. Now, when we talk about India, Examples are caste-based inequalities, gender inequalities. We are basically a patriarchal society. So gender-based inequality prevails in India. Again, caste-based inequalities, economic inequalities are very high in India. So all these will come under reduced inequalities. Why I am stressing on or focusing on Indian perspective is because we are writing an exam which is related to our country. So that's why I am giving the examples from India. But always, always remember that the SDGs or the Sustainable Development Goals, they are global goals. Now, 11th one is Sustainable Cities and Communities. Sustainable Cities and Communities, which means urbanization. Cities refers to urbanization and creation of communities. Sustainable, that means keeping in view the needs of the future generation as well. So, that is what is covered under the 11th goal, that is sustainability, considering the needs for the future generation as well and judicious use of resources. 12th is responsible consumption and production. So consumption and production should be carried out judiciously in order to ensure that the environmental resources or the natural resources does not deplete very soon. Then 13 is also very, very important, and 13th goal, that is climate action, you have to learn it very in depth or comprehensively for your NET examination as well, because in the syllabus we have seen that climate change is one important topic that is mentioned in your syllabus. So climate action we will see in detail. So this refers to various factors relating to climate change, various measures taken to deal with it, and also what are the factors responsible for it. Then next one is life below water, that is marine resources. Regarding marine resources, depletion of marine resources, what are the steps taken and what are the factors or reasons causing a depletion to marine resources. 15 is life on land, that is life on this earth. So, and the 16th one is peace, justice and strong institutions. So these are all the goals under the 16th Sustainable Development Goal. 17 is partnership. Partnership here refers to international partnership or partnership between countries, between organizations. So global partnership to achieve these goals. So these are the 17 Sustainable Development Goals in brief. Don't worry, we have not covered it comprehensively. We will be covering each one of them in detail considering your examination requirements. We will also see how these questions are asked in the previous years. We will see from these module how the questions are framed in the previous years, and accordingly we will be covering. I think quickly we will just take up some questions that are asked. Now the next subtopic which comes under your syllabus is human and environment interaction. As we introduced the syllabus to you, I told you that there is a topic which deals with human environment interaction, that is how human beings and environment are interrelated with each other, how environment needs human beings and how human beings need environment, or how they are dependent upon each other, and also how the human activities, which are called anthropogenic activities, how the human activities are causing both positive as well as negative impacts on the environment. So this is what this particular subtopic deals with. So here environment refers to biotic components and abiotic components. So biotic components are those components which has life. So these are called biotic. Biotic means has life, and abiotic means which does not have life. Biotic examples are animals or plants. These are all biotic components. Abiotic components like soil, water, which does not have life, but these are environmental components, components of the environment. So we will see how human beings are dependent upon both biotic and abiotic components in the environment, and how the human activities are causing some impact. So impact in the sense both positive and negative impact on the environment. So this is what we will be dealing here in this subtopic. We will cover it in detail. Next is anthropogenic activities on environment. So this is what we said. Anthropogenic activities means human activities or man-made activities. So how it causes impact, both the benefits as well as the harmful impacts. So benefit, we can say that it is developmental activities. So the human environment interaction, it leads to development activities, and harmful activities is depletion of environment. So this is anthropogenic activities and their impact on the environment. Next is environmental issues, which is again a very important subtopic that is mentioned in your syllabus. So you have to learn about global issues, regional issues, and also local issues. And from this particular subtopics, many questions are asked in the previous years, especially global issues like climate change, like greenhouse gas effect. So greenhouse gas effects and then global warming, all these questions are asked many times in the previous years. So very important. We will also go through the previous year questions. Don't worry about it. So we will solve the previous year questions to familiarize you with the pattern, how the questions are being asked. So under environmental issues, we have to learn all of them: global issues, regional issues, and local issues. Then another important topic is pollution. So pollution are of different types. There are different types of pollution. One is air pollution. Another is water pollution. Another one is soil pollution, noise pollution, again thermal pollution, and solid waste pollution. Each one we will cover in detail. And when we cover this particular topic, pollution, we will see what are the first thing that we will see is what are the agents of pollution. Agents means causing factors. I'm really sorry, I'm not able to write properly. Please excuse me for that. So first thing that we will be learning is what are the different agents of pollution, or what are the factors that causes pollution. For example, if we consider air pollution, what are the different gases that causes air pollution? For example, CO2. So I'm really sorry, I'm not able to write well, but I'll definitely rectify this error in the next video. So like that we will study. So first thing we will study, what are the agents of pollution? Then we will see what are the causes of pollution, causes or reasons of pollution. Then we will see how human activities has resulted into these causes. So human activities. Then we will also discuss about what are the solutions, and then we will see what are the government measures, what are the measures taken by the government to control the pollution levels, especially air pollution. Very important, because examples like Delhi, the cities of Delhi and other places are facing severe threats because of air pollution. And then the same thing I discussed. So what we'll be doing is we will discuss about the sources of pollution, and under that we will see what are the natural sources of pollution. It's not that pollution is always anthropogenic or it's always a result of human activities. It can be natural as well. So natural pollution or natural sources of pollution and anthropogenic sources of pollution. So this is what we will discuss under sources. Then we will see what are the impacts, then what are the control measures, we will see possible solutions, and also what are the solutions taken by the government already. We will also be discussing about pollutants. Again, pollutants are also a subtopic given in your syllabus. So we will see different types of pollutants. So these are the broad classifications, but details we will see when we are dealing with this particular subtopic. So these are the broad classification. One type of classification is primary pollutants and secondary pollutants. So these are one type of pollutants. Second classification is biodegradable and non-biodegradable. So biodegradable pollutants and non-biodegradable. Okay, so plastic is one example, and biodegradable is like food waste. All these are biodegradable, they are degradable. And then third category is qualitative and quantitative pollutants. So quantitative pollutants and qualitative. Then another subtopic is global issues. So again, global issues is another subtopic in your syllabus. So here we will be discussing about some of the very important major global issues. So it includes El Nino. Don't worry if you have not heard this term El Nino before. Don't worry, we will go into the detail. We will see what is important from your examination perspective. We will definitely cover. Then acid rains, another important one. Then global warming and greenhouse effect. So this is again very, very important. This is one particular area from which maximum questions can be asked from this subtopic, global issues. So global warming and greenhouse effect. So global warming and greenhouse effect. Then ozone depletion, again very important. Why? Because again we will see Montreal Protocol, how it is related to this. And Montreal Protocol is very important, and it's mentioned in your syllabus like that. So you have to cover that. Then another one is land degradation and desertification. Desertification means increased rates of deforestation leading to desertification, absence of plant life. So desertification is absence of plant life, and land degradation means the quality of land, the quality is being reduced. That is land degradation. So land not suitable for cultivation, or land not suitable for some agricultural activities. So this is land degradation. And desertification means increased rates of deforestation. So when deforestation is cutting down the trees, so when the rate of deforestation increases, it leads to desertification. That means a particular area will not have plant life, or very less plant life. The vegetation will be very less, and this will have climatic impacts. So this is desertification. I'm sorry. So this also we will see under global issues. Then we will be discussing about the natural resources. So natural resources can be again broadly classified into two categories. One is renewable energy resources and non-renewable resources. Not only energy, renewable resources in general. So sorry for the mistake. Renewable resources and non-renewable. Now what is meant by renewable resource? I'll give you a small idea. Renewable resource means any natural resource or any resource that can be renewed or replenished over a period of time. For example, I have given many examples which we will be discussing: solar, wind energy, hydro, biomass, geothermal. So these are all renewable resources, which means after a certain period of time, even if we consume a lot of solar energy, this can be regained in the future. So we will get it back in the future. We can regain them in the future. That is why we are giving a focus on increased use of renewable energy, or substitution of non-renewable energy with that of the renewable energy. Now, what is non-renewable sources of energy or non-renewable resources? Non-renewable resources is just the opposite that we discussed. So non-renewable, they are not renewable. They cannot be replenished or they cannot be regained in a course of time. Examples are fossil fuels, earth minerals, metal ores, etc. So if we consume them in large numbers or in large quantity, it will get completely extinct from the environment, from the earth. We cannot regain them. So they will not automatically be regenerated or regained in the future. So that is why we should use the non-renewable resources more judiciously in order to ensure that these resources are also available for the future generations. Now, can you tell me why the government is giving more focus on the usage of renewable energy? I guess you got the idea. This renewable energy can be regained. So that is why the government is giving more focus on renewable energy. The reason being, these resources can be replenished. For example, solar energy. We have the ISA, or the International Solar Alliance. And India is one among the founding members of ISA, International Solar Alliance. And also India is the country which has taken the leadership for ISA. The reason is that the renewable energy can be regained back. Whereas if we use non-renewable energy in large quantities, they cannot be regained. So that is the basic difference. We will look into the details when we deal with this particular subtopic. Now, next topic is natural hazards and disasters. Many of you might be thinking that hazards and disasters, they are the same, but they are not the same. We will see what is the difference. So what is a hazard? Hazard means it's a dangerous situation or an event that carries a threat to humans. So an event or a dangerous situation that poses some kind of risk to the human beings is called hazard. Now we will see what is a disaster, then we will come to the difference. So disaster means an event that actually harms human beings and disrupts the operation of society. Now, what is the difference? In both the cases, we have seen that it is a situation where human beings are under threat. So, what can be the difference? Now, the difference is that all the hazards are not disasters. Why? All the hazards are not disasters because hazards will become a disaster only if they affect humans. So, if suppose this circle, this is hazards, only a few of the hazards will become a disaster. Now, disaster is conditional. What is the condition? So, every disaster is a hazard, whereas every hazard is not a disaster. Why? Because in order to become a disaster, hazards have to affect the human beings. So, hazards is considered to be a disaster when it affects the human beings. And if they occur in an unpopulated area, it will remain as a hazard. Now, can you give me some example of hazards and disasters? So, disaster, one example is very recent examples. Can you just recollect? Flood. Even now, in many places of our country, events of flood is going on. So, if the flood occurs, mostly the flood occurs in populated areas. In the especially in the river banks, etc., the floods majorly occur in populated areas, so it's a disaster. Again, another example of disaster, can you give me any recent examples? Cyclone, yes, somebody has given this example of cyclone, yes. Odisha, yes, Anjali, you are correct. So, Odisha is one state which is frequently affected by cyclones. So, cyclone is a very good example of a disaster. Then, hazards. Can you give me an example of a hazard? For example, if a factory, suppose there is a power short or there is some fire in a factory when the employees are not available there. So, when the employees are not there, that means that is not populated, then this is a hazard. So, hazards can be even natural as well as human-made. Natural hazards like thunder, lightning. So, these are some natural hazards. So, these are the basic differences between hazards and disasters. We will come into the details later. Now, these are some of the examples. Earthquakes. Earthquakes are disasters. Then flood, droughts, volcanic eruptions, tsunami, landslides, subsidence, hurricanes, tornadoes, and asteroid impacts. These are some examples of some natural hazards. So, these are some examples. Now, let's come to disaster risk management cycle, which is also a subtopic that you have to learn in your syllabus. So, disaster risk management cycle. So, first one is response. Response is how you are responding to the disaster. So, response. Second one is rehabilitation and recovery. Third is prevention and mitigation and preparedness. So, these are the five important steps that needs to be taken to deal with any disaster. Now, let's take a very simple example in order to understand all these steps or all these factors. So, for example, let us take the example of a flood. Now, there is an ongoing flood in eastern part of our country. So, let's take that example. Now, flood. The first thing is response, how you are responding to it. So, it requires various measures, response measures that needs to be taken. It can be taken at the local level, the administrative level, the district level, the district administration, which is headed by the district magistrate, can take this step. So, response. Second one is rehabilitation and recovery. So, those who are affected by the flood, they need to be rehabilitated. They need to be provided some safe shelters and recovery. Then next is prevention and mitigation measures. So, in the future, how we can prevent it, how we can mitigate such risk and preparedness. So, preparedness is again very important that we are being prepared for any disaster. So, these are the various steps involved in the disaster risk management cycle, which we will be discussing in detail. Each one of them we will see in detail. Now, another important topic for your examination is UN conferences on environment. So, this is another topic, the UN conference. The UN is United Nations. UN refers to United Nations. So, conferences, various conferences were held under the initiative of United Nations. And in your syllabus, certain things are mentioned. We will be covering those conferences in detail and those initiatives in detail. Very important ones. These are the most important conferences that are initiated by the UN. One is Stockholm Conference in the year 1972. Again, Nairobi Summit in 1982. Now, Earth Summit in 1992. Then, this was also called Rio Summit. Why Rio Summit? Because it was held in Rio de Janeiro. Then, Johannesburg Summit in 2002. That is after 10 years. So, this is also called Plus 10. Earth Summit Plus 10. That is after 10 years. Then, after 20 years of Earth Summit, that is Rio plus 20. As we said, Earth Summit is also called Rio Summit. Why Rio Summit? It was held in Rio de Janeiro. So, Rio plus 20 was held in 2012. That is after 20 years of Earth Summit. So, why after this 20 years? This is to review the activities or initiatives taken under the Earth Summit. So, these three, they are together. We need to learn these three summits together. Earth Summit of 1992, Johannesburg Summit of 2002 and 2012, Rio Plus 20 Summit. Now, Nairobi Summit, Stockholm Summit or conference, all these names are given according to the place in which these conferences were held or according to the host country or the location of the conference. So, that is why these names, we will come to it, we will see what are the important things to be learned under these conferences. Then very important is multilateral environment agreements. So what is meant by this term multilateral? Multilateral or multilateral, it refers to an initiative that is taken at the global level where many countries or many number of countries and also the international organizations are the participants. So international organizations plus many countries. So, that is why it is called multilateral. So, some of the important multilateral environmental agreements. One is CITES of 1973. We will see what is CITES in detail. Vienna Convention of 1985. Third is Montreal Protocol of 1987. Then Basel Convention of 1989, UNFCCC, that is United Nations Climate Change Conference, 1992. Then CBD, Convention on Biodiversity, that is CBD 1992. So all these international or multilateral environment agreements are mentioned in your syllabus, therefore they are very important. So you might be thinking, I'll just tell you something more. So, you might be thinking paper 1 is just for 50 marks and also this is just one unit of paper 1. So, why should you learn all these in much detail? I'll tell you why. So, this is a national level examination. NET is a national level examination. And as we said, the marks is out of total 300 and out of which 200 marks will be awarded for your paper 2, which covers your subject of expertise, whereas the 100 marks is common for everyone, that is for paper 1, which is common for everyone. Now, how you can make an edge or how you can get an edge in the examination? This 100 marks will definitely give you a edge over the others. So, to clear this cutoff, and especially if you're preparing for JRF, you need a little more, slightly higher cutoff. So, to clear the cutoff, this 50 questions, 100 marks will give you an advantage. Not everyone will be very good in this paper 1. But everyone who are appearing for NET, most of them who are appearing for this examination, they will be very good in their subject. At least because they have learned the subject in their graduation and post-graduation. So, considering that fact, they will be experts or at least they will have some level of knowledge in their subjects. So, this 200 marks So this is almost a kind of level player for everyone. Those who have the subject knowledge, they will be easily able to get very good marks in paper 2. Whereas in paper 1, here you will get an advantage because this 100 marks, which is 1/3 of your total marks, you can easily get this marks if you have covered the syllabus in paper 1. And not everyone, believe me, not everyone will cover the entire syllabus. And it's very easy also. So if you look into the syllabus, you will see that it's very easy. Paper 1 is very easy. If you cover the syllabus, and if you have a minimum level of preparation, if you have some kind of good kind of preparation for paper 1, then definitely you will have an advantage over others in paper 1, and we are trying to give you that advantage. So please attend the classes regularly, also revise your notes regularly so that you have an advantage in paper 1. So 100 marks guaranteed, at least some 80 to 90 marks can be guaranteed if you have some good level of preparation for paper 1. This definitely will give you an edge over others. So let's come back to the topic. Next is, we are not done with multilateral environment agreements. Don't think that with CBD it's done. There are a lot more agreements that we need to study in some detail, not in depth, because you are not going to become experts in these topics, but you have to know what it is and what it is related to. That is enough. So what are the objectives of this conventions and agreements, and what is it related to? That is enough for your examination. Now, no, Rotterdam Convention in 1998. So Rotterdam Convention, then Cartagena Protocol 2000, in the year 2000, Stockholm Convention. So do not confuse with the Stockholm Conference. Both are different. Stockholm Convention, and we have the Nagoya Protocol in 2010. Then we have the Minamata Convention in 2013, and very important is International Solar Alliance. And the reason is that, one reason is that India has initiated this. Second one, India is a founding member. And third thing is that we have given lot of policy attention towards this particular international agreement, that is International Solar Alliance. So International Solar Alliance also we will be covering in detail. So this was signed in 2015. So these are some of the important multilateral agreements which you need to cover for your examination. Next is various acts and policies, which is also mentioned in your syllabus. All these names, I have taken it out from your syllabus. And this lecture, please don't think that I am going very fast. This is just to introduce and familiarize the syllabus to you. But from the next lecture onwards, we will be going into all of these in detail. Don't worry about it. And even before we move on to the subjects or the subtopics directly, we will also be covering some important terminologies related to ecology and environment, so that as we proceed with the lecture, you will not have any doubts or any clarifications required. You will have some basic knowledge about ecology and environment, and upon building the basic knowledge about this particular unit, then we will move on with the topics. Don't worry about it. I'll make sure that you will answer at least 90% of the questions that comes from this particular unit. So under various acts and policies, we have to learn about the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. So this act basically provides protection to the wildlife. Wildlife means animals and all the other wildlife. Another is Environmental Protection Act of 1986. Environmental Protection Act. So you have to remember here that the first is Wildlife Protection Act, and then we had a Environmental Protection Act. Next is National Forest Policy of 1988. Forest Policy. Then, I'm sorry for the error. It's a Biological Diversity Act. So BD Act, Biological Diversity Act of 2002. So these are the various acts and policies that you have to study for your examination. All of these are mentioned in your syllabus. Next is Scheduled Tribes and Other Forest Dwellers Act of 2006. So here we will be discussing about what are the rights of the tribals. So what are the rights with regard to minor forest produce? So what kind of rights the tribals have with regard to minor forest produce? And then we will also be discussing about TRIFED, very important body. So, Scheduled Tribes and other Forest Dwellers Act, which provides for the rights of the forest dwellers on the forest. We will see who are forest dwellers and what is the definition given to them. Next is Coastal Regulation Zones in India. Then the rules related to protection of wetlands. Then we will see NGT, National Green Tribunal, in detail. Then we will also be discussing about the ozone depleting substances rules. Okay, so these are the topics. I hope now you are familiar with all the topics. So let's quickly once again go through the syllabus. So here, if you quickly glance through the syllabus, you will see that I have covered all the important topics or all the subtopics mentioned in your syllabus. So we will be covering each one in detail in each lectures. So there are basically seven subtopics mentioned in your syllabus. Maybe it will take one or two lectures for completing one subtopic depending on the length of the topic. So in maximum two lectures we'll be covering each. Okay. And next lecture we will not be going directly into development and environment, millennium development goals and sustainable development goals. But before that, we will be looking into some important terms and terminologies related with ecology and environment. And as we have just 6 or 7 more minutes left for the session, I am not going into it. But you can see here, I have prepared some very important, some important terms and terminologies just to make you familiarize with these terms, so that when we deal with all these topics, you will find it very easy to move on with these topics. So for that purpose, I have I'll be explaining. I have made the notes for some of the important terms and terminology. So we will be discussing that tomorrow. So now quickly, the last 5 minutes, I'll take up the questions that you have asked me. So yeah, many of you. Hi Priyanka, Neetu, Rahul, Meenakshi, Sharvana, Madhu. Hi everyone.